Welcome to this session in which we would look at a bonds payable issuance, a topic that's covered on the CPA exam as well as intermediate accounting. Now, this topic is important because bonds is a critical component of the CPA exam. So if you're not comfortable with the topics of bonds, you should not sit for the CPA exam. Specifically, this exercise, I would say considered an advanced exercise in a sense that you're going to be dealing with accrued interest, and you're going to be dealing with the bond issued other than the issuance date. So you have many issues to deal with in this problem. So if you understand this problem, that's great. If not, you need to go back and learn your basics about bond, because you cannot go into the exam without having a strong foundation. Like, this exercise is more than a basic. But if you feel you're totally confused, then you have to go back and review bond basics. But before we start, I would like to remind you, whether you're a CPA candidate or an accounting student, I strongly suggest you take a look at my website, farhatlectures.com. I don't replace your CPA review course. Most likely you are taking a CPA review course. That's great. I am a useful addition. I can be an additional resource, an alternative explanation for your CPA material, which in turn will help you with your review course, which in turn will help you pass the exam. Your risk is 1 month of subscription. Your potential gain is passing the exam. I align my courses to go with your courses, so it's easy to follow my courses along your other course. And if not for anything, take a look at my website to find out how well or not well your university is doing on the CPA exam. And this is a list of all the courses that I cover. If you haven't connected with me on LinkedIn, please do so. Take a look at my LinkedIn recommendation. Like this recording, share it with others, subscribe. Connect with me on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and Reddit. So let's take a look at this exercise. Adam issued 800,000 6% bond at 97.5 plus accrued interest on August 1st, 2001. That's fine. This is when we issued the bond. August 1st, 800,000 is the face value. It's paying 6%. It was issued at 97.5. Obviously, it was issued at a discount. And we issued it plus accrued interest. Once we say accrued interest, it means the bond was not issued at its initial date. What does that mean? Let's read further. The bonds are, not AE, are 9-year bonds dated December 1st, 2000. So they were dated, the original date of the bond was December 1st, but we did not issue them until August 1st. So simply put, if this is year one and this is year two, this is when they were actually, if you look at the bond itself, it's dated December 1st. Let's make it year zero. And let's make this year one to be consistent. It was not issued until August 1st. So notice there is December, January, February, March, April, May, June, and July. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. There is 8 months between the date is what it was dated and the date it was issued. So that's the first thing. That's why we might have to deal with some accrued interest. It paid interest on June 1st and December 31st. Now, this is important. Although it was not issued until that time, that's fine, but it pays interest on December and on June. What does that mean? It means we are going to be assuming that all the accrued interest was made, was prepared. Okay? Now, the company uses the straight line method for bond amortization and calendar year as fiscal year. That's fine. Their calendar year is the same as their fiscal year, which is December 31st. First, they want us to prepare the journal entry on August 1st when it was issued. So the journal entry here. Well, let's take a look at it. How much did we sell the bond for? Well, we sell the bond. Let me get the calculator here. First, let's start with the cash. So 800,000 times 0.975, and that's going to give us 780,000. That's for the bond itself. So let's see. So let me write this down. I'm going to keep the calculator up and write things down to show you how we're going to get to the cash amount. Here we go. Okay. So we took 800,000 times 0.975, and we got, let me do it again, times 975, we got 780,000. That's for the bond itself. That's for the bond itself. Now, what does that mean? If this is the bond, this is the bond itself, it means we have a discount equal to 20,000. The discount is equal to 20,000 because what is the discount? The discount is the difference between the face value and how much cash we received for the bond. In addition to the bond, we received, notice in the problem, it says you received accrued interest. Now you have to be careful. The problem might say the 0.975 include the interest or it doesn't include the interest. Usually it does not include the interest. So you have to compute the interest separately. Now, how do we compute the interest? Well, we're going to compute the interest only for 2 months because we're going to be assuming that the company was accruing the interest on this bond as they, as time goes by because it was dated December 1st. So let me use a different color. So we're going to accrue interest for from, this is June 1st. We're going to accrue the interest for all of June and all of July. In other words, we're going to have 800,000 times 6% times 2 divided by 12. So let's do it here. So 2 divided by 12 times, let me reset here. 2 divided by 12 times 0.06 times 800,000. And that's an additional 8,000 of accrued interest. So we're going to be receiving the price of the bond, 780 plus 8,000 of accrued interest. Therefore, cash is 788,000. Remember, of this amount, 780 is the bond itself, and 8,000 is the accrued interest from since June, so June and July. Now the bond will always be credited for the face value, 800,000. We're gonna record the discount, which is 20,000, the difference between 780 and the face value, 800,000. And we have to have interest expense credit of 8,000. Now, whether you do interest expense or interest payable, that's fine, but usually you credit interest expense. Why? Because we are basically holding the bond. So really, we're not going to charge ourselves. Therefore, we credit interest expense. So this is the entry that takes place on August 1st. Now, from August 1st till December 1st, remember, from August 1st till December 1st, we're going to make the first interest payment. Remember, the bond pays interest on December 1st. This is when it pays interest. Okay? So what's going to happen is this. We're going to have six months worth of interest in terms of cash payment. So let's start with the cash, with the cash amount. Well, first, the cash amount. The cash amount is 800,000, because this is the easy part, times 6%. And that's equal to 24,000. This is the cash amount. Now, remember, this bond is a discount bond. So now we're going to have to amortize some of the discount and record the interest expense. We know the cash is 24,000, and we know that the interest expense, it's going to be more than the cash. Why? Because this bond is a discount bond, and what are we going to do? We're going to take this discount and amortize it over the life of the bond, and we're going to add portion of that amortization to the cash that we paid. Let me explain. Okay. First, this is, we're using the straight line method. This is a 9-year bond. 9 times 12. The total number of month is 108. Now, remember, we did not issue this bond until 8 months later. So we don't start the amortization until we actually issue the bond. So think about it. From December 1st, year 0, till August 1st, year 1, 8 months went by. So we're going to take 108 minus 8. So we're going to be amortizing the bond over 100 months. Why? Because we don't start the amortization until we issue the bond. Therefore, we're going to take 20,000 divided by 100 month. In other words, we're going to amortize $200 per month, $200 per month over the life of this bond. Now, we're going to amortize August, all of August, September, October, and November, and all of November, because we pay on December 1st. So we're going to amortize over 4 months. Therefore, we're going to amortize $800. Therefore, the interest expense, so the discount amortized is $800. Therefore, the interest expense is the cash plus the cash plus the discount. The interest expense is 24,000 800. So this is how we amortize, this is how much we amortize of the bond. Now, they're also asking us to prepare the entry on December 1st, which is the end of the year. Well, from December 1st till December 31st, we only have to deal with 1 month. What does that mean? It means we have to, everything that we did here, we have to do everything that we did in this entry here, we have to do for 1 month. What does that mean? It means if we're going to take 800,000 times 6% times 112. So let's do this. So this is the amount of the supposedly the cash, but we're not going to be paying cash. So let's start with the fraction. So we're going to take 1 divided by 12 times 0.06 times 800,000. So that's going to be $4,000, and that's going to be the interest payable. Now, because we're not paying the money. Okay, otherwise we would, that would have been the cash amount, but we're not paying the money. So interest payable is 4,000. Now the same thing, we have to amortize the discount for 1 month. And we already know for 1 month equal to $200, we just did it earlier. Then bond interest expense is the total of those two, which is 4,200 is the bond interest expense. And this is the amount that we accrue on December 31st. So what does this entry represent? It represents the accrual for 1 month worth of interest. What does December 1st represent? December 1st represent the payment of 6 months worth of interest, which involved the full payment of $24,000. So this is basically, those are the three journal entries that you need to be familiar with, and you need to be comfortable with these journal entries as you go through the exam day. Why? Because bond is a major topic on the exam. So if you're not comfortable with this topic and you get to the exam, what's going to happen is the AICPA software, I can assure you, they will know that you are not comfortable with this major topic. And if you're not comfortable with this topic and maybe another major topic, you'll be heading toward a score below 75%, which is not good. At the end of this recording, once again, I'm going to invite you to take a look at my website, farhatlectures.com, where I have resources for your CPA review course. Again, I don't replace your CPA review course. I provide to you alternative resources, explanation, exercises that's going to help you understand and strengthen your ability to pass the exam. Study hard for the exam. It's worth it. Studying for the CPA exam is worth it. You do this once in your lifetime. Don't shortchange yourself. Good luck, study hard, and of course, stay safe.